For Creamer Media's Policy, I'm Sashni Badli. Joining me today is African National Congress National Spokesperson Mahlengi Bhengu-Motsiri, here to unpack the party's 2024 manifesto ahead of the May elections. The ANC has set out six priorities to focus on in its manifesto, and one of those is the plan to stimulate employment by creating 2.5 million job opportunities within 5 years, or over 5 years. What would you say to those who see this as wholly insufficient in light of the country's extreme jobless rates?
Well, this is a continuation of the work that was started by the ANC 30 years ago. And I want to really frame this conversation with your audience around the fact that we are, in this year, celebrating the 30 years of democracy against a set of 300 years of colonialism and the dispossession and the disenfranchisement of the people of South Africa, the poorest of the poor, the black, and black meaning Africans, colored, and Indians. And so when you look at that journey that has been traveled by the African National Congress alongside the people of South Africa, you will have an appreciation for the jobs challenge. And now this is now back to your question. You will have an appreciation for the jobs challenge. You would also have an appreciation for the work that has been done to create employment, but not nearly enough, given the challenges and given the fact that we have a growing youth base and a youth population. We also are a home to Africans who come to South Africa, including those from other countries who come to South Africa, because there is a perception that we are a soft landing for whatever reasons. And I think it's generally good reasons. So government is overstretched in terms of its budget. And the jobs plan that we present in our manifesto is scientifically tested. We used our policy and research capacity to actually determine a set of data sets that speaks to this point.
Corruption is one of the biggest issues associated with the ANC, which some have linked directly to your catered deployment policy. Why is the ANC sticking with this policy?
The ANC embarked on a program called the renewal of the ANC. And it was essentially a thing of improving the way the ANC connects with the people of South Africa, to go back to what our founding fathers, including Nelson Mandela and countless others that have left us, the directives they left us with, making sure that all of those things are attended to. And one of those is addressing the demon of corruption and clarifying that the ANC is not a corrupt organization. We may have had, and we may have members that are corrupt, but it is not the ANC that actually attends to them to practice corruption. So it's important to understate that fact. Secondly, as part of underscoring that fact, we have embarked on what we refer to as several actions to bring to the fore the renewal agenda, one of which is the Integrity Commission of the ANC, which is hard at work. That is actually, as soon as there is any allegation about, against you or me, you get asked to appear, get summoned to appear before the Integrity Commission. And of course, if you've been convicted by the courts of our land, you automatically have to step aside. Those are all of the interventions by the ANC to make sure that corruption is being dealt with. I could go on and on and on, just giving you a sense of how we're really modernizing the work we're doing to ensure that ethics and integrity management is upheld in the organization. CADA deployment is practiced elsewhere and everywhere. You can go to the US, can go to the UK, and you can go to Asia. You will find this being a long-term practice. It's not unique to South Africa. And sometimes people, there's a bit of lazy journalism, because this is something that is all ought to be well-researched, to be honest. But it's nothing untoward. It's nothing that is not the same as when, you know, the House of Commons in the United Kingdom decide that the clerk of parliament, senior clerk of parliament, what in South Africa we call secretary to parliament or the provincial legislature. All of those things are done everywhere, because once the people have actually given you the mandate to govern by voting for you, surely it is not expected that you go in there blind spotted without the human capital that understands the policies of the party that has been voted in. So we don't see anything untoward about our cadre deployment policy. We'll continue to practice it, and we will improve it to make sure that where there have been many failings, for example, people without extensive set of qualifications, that we clean that up. And I think you will see that in our candidate list to parliament that day. ANC is very serious about meritocracy.
Now, crime is a massive scourge in the country, particularly for women and children. How is the integrated strategy outlined in the manifesto a departure from previous failed strategies?
Well, I'm not so sure that there are previously failed strategies overall, given the fact that we have a very strong anti-gender-based and femicide violence campaign in South Africa. And that is the work done by the ANC-led government, but also that is the work done by the Women's League of the ANC. And there's a lot of consciousness around the issue of gender-based violence. For example, I'm just using that as an example. We need to step up. It's not enough. The fact that, again, this is not unique to South Africa. You go to India and you look at how in every minute the rapes that happen there of women and children. So we need to make sure that, for example, we partner with other countries that are facing the same challenge. Secondly, we on our own need to intensify campaigns aimed at tackling the scourge and the pandemic. It's actually a pandemic of gender-based violence. And this is something that the manifesto commits to do. The president launched an action plan some 2 years ago, an action plan aimed at tackling this on several fronts, from research all the way to practical actions on the ground. So you can't fix what is not broken. We need to make sure that that action plan is given much more momentum, and then we proceed. So that's basically the way we are looking at the work in that space. I mean, there are care centers that have been established as a result of that action plan. They are NGOs, and the ANC has been doing a lot of sectoral mobilization with different sectors in society to maximize the work of government and to really bring and shine a spotlight on the issue of gender-based violence. That's just but one example. But overall, the crime issue, you are correct, is a matter of serious concern. And there are a very clear set of interventions that are proposed in our manifesto. We're going to be unveiling them. Look out for our press briefing also in about 2 days, where we're going to be unpacking our peace and stability intervention in the next 5 years. Continuation again from the work we started doing, but now taking it to the next level.
Load shedding has been crippling the economy for years, and the ANC has thus far failed to ensure security of supply. Why should there be any trust in the ANC's latest sets of promises to end load shedding?
You are speaking to us as the ANC, at a time when we have almost 2 weeks of no load shedding, unprecedented. I just wanted to remind you of that. That is why at the moment our colleagues in the media when we speak, they say there's not much to talk about that. We're looking for other controversy because ANC is doing well. We have no load shedding. We have no load shedding in South Africa today, and businesses are, you know, sort of upping their ante in terms of their businesses because there's more energy supply. And it's a function of hard work by those that are deployed by the ANC in government, particularly led by Minister Sputla Hosienzo Ramokhuba.
But what are the party's plans to ensure the security of supply going forward?
Oh, there's a very, very strong energy mix plan that has been shared with all manner of stakeholders in South Africa, including business, including community, including trade unions, to make sure that we follow through on the policy of the ANC adopted at the 55th National Conference and in previous conferences around issues of energy supply, and by making sure that there's an energy mix solution that serves the people of South Africa without disadvantaging also the businesses and in particular the role of trade unions, and looking at how we use coal, how we use renewable energy, how we use all of that in a way that doesn't undermine all of the things that we need to be doing in the environment. So we're comfortable with what we have in our manifesto.
And part of that is to promote cheaper and subsidized solar power. So where will the money for this come from?
Yes, of course, that is already part of the plan. In fact, it's being executed. Have a look at the work that is being done in Gauteng, which is obviously the most metropolitan space in South Africa. Have a look at the transformer program. Have a look at the solar power across the country. It's a done by people that can afford, the middle class, for example, who have grown as a strata in South Africa, largely as a result of ANC-led government policies that have grown the middle class and people that are able to fend for themselves. We're concerned about those that can't fend for themselves, and but look at the middle class and look at their homes and how, you know, and you will see solar being installed day in and day out. So this is obviously something that is within the radar of the energy mix that I spoke about in our policy.
Now, the national health insurance has come under massive scrutiny, with many people opposed not to the idea, but whether it can be funded and implemented in a way that doesn't invite corruption. How do you respond?
The most important thing to say about that is that in our manifesto, the ANC commits to expand universal health care to all, particularly the poorest of the poor. NHI is just but one of the many contributions to that work. We have already done a lot in the past 30 years. If there's anything that you can criticize the ANC on, will not be on social transformation matters. The fact that people have got free healthcare in clinics, and the fact that young people, young women are doctors and are specializing in various disciplines in the health domain is a testament to the success of our policies on the health front. NHI is very important for countless reasons, as you would know. I don't even understand this narrative about it attracting corruption, because your question suggests that the ANC is associated with corruption. And I would clarify this point earlier. It would not attract corruption, NHI, because it enjoys huge support from the people of South Africa that are going to be affected positively, impacted positively by this policy. And I don't even understand where the idea of corruption comes from. Those who are opposed to the NHI, they're opposed to the NHI on an ideological basis. That's the opposition, particularly the Democratic Alliance. They are opposed to it not on the basis of corruption, their so-called corruption. They are opposed to it on the basis of the fact that they don't think that the poorest of the poor and those that are not covered currently by health policies deserve to have that access.
Some polls suggest that the ANC is unlikely to secure a clear majority, and could fall into a territory where only a coalition with a large party will enable it to form a government. So what is the party's coalition strategy, and who will you and won't you consider partnering with?
We have not spent time discussing a coalition strategy. We have no such a strategy. We are going for an outward majority. It's as black and white as that. I see that opposition parties are communicating a lot about, you know, I would be willing to work with the ANC, or I won't want to work with this. We're not discussing that kind of thing. We're focusing on our campaign, and we're aiming for the outright majority. We are on the ground wherever we are going. I myself was on the campaign trail with the president. I can tell you, you know, our ground is seriously energized. It's almost as if it's 1994. We're not thinking about other parties or focusing on the message of the ANC.
The ANC's legal and political strategies regarding Jacob Zuma's Mkhonto we Sizwe party have fallen well short. And it seems incredible that an ANC member can be leading an opposition party. Is the ANC rethinking its approach to the MK party and Jacob Zuma? And would the party consider such a coalition with the party?
No such a thing. He's not a member of the ANC at the moment. He's suspended from the ANC, if you're following developments in South Africa. But there's no such a thing. The ANC is only one. Any form of ill-discipline is taken very seriously and is frowned upon, which is why the National Disciplinary Committee of the ANC recommended his suspension. There's no worry about the MK party on the part of the ANC. The 29th of May would obviously be the defining moment, and we're looking forward to that.
And lastly, 30 years into democracy, there are still glaring socioeconomic gaps, some of which are trending in the wrong direction. Why should voters contemplate giving the ANC another chance to govern when it has not been able to address some of the problems of jobs, poverty, and inequality over successive administrations?
Well, I suppose if you really look at the history of South Africa and you look at 300 years of colonial rule, where people were disenfranchised, needed to produce passes or IDs in order to get out of the house and go to the next place, where women were not allowed to enroll for science degrees because it was deemed that they're not smart enough to be able to enroll for science degrees. If you look at the fact that for women to go and give birth, they would go to hospitals that were designated for blacks without any facilities. If you look at the fact that to access higher education, even actually secondary education, but to access higher education, you really needed to be exceptional, you know, to be part of what they call the petty bourgeoisie in other modern societies. If you look at that collection of all of that, if you look at the passing of the 1913 Land Act, which sought to dispossess Africans from ownership of the land and the land ownership patterns as an overall, if you look at the economy where black people were subjugated to beer halls, were built instead of creating productivity in the economy and stimulating the economy for all. If you look at all of that, then you will understand why South Africans should vote ANC. And South Africans are going to vote ANC. They are saying that, including young people. 30 years of democracy against 300 years of colonial rule, I think you can judge for yourself.
That was ANC National Spokesperson Mahlengi Bhengu-Motsiri unpacking the party's 2024 manifesto ahead of the May elections.